Scientists have discovered that the sun is cooling and the Earth faces an ice age within 15 years. The solar magnetic activity is set to drop by up to 60% in the next 15 years. This discovery was made by Valentina Sarkova and her colleagues. They derived their model using a technique called principal component analysis of the magnetic field from their observations from the Wilcox Solar Observatory in California. Experts say that solar activity as low as now has not been seen since the mini ice age that took place between 1645 and 1715, a period known as the Maunder Minimum. A new model has allowed experts to predict solar activity with more accuracy than ever before, and it suggests that magnetic activity will fall by 60% between 2030 and 2040. And this model looks at Sun's 11th year heartbeat, the period it takes for magnetic activity to fluctuate. This cycle was first discovered 173 years ago. The scientist Valentina Sarkova and her colleagues from Northumbria University applied the most up-to-date theory and was able to predict the effects of solar cycles with 97% accuracy. Sarkova said at the National Astronomy Meeting, "We found magnetic wave components appearing in pairs, originating in two different layers in the sun's interior. They both have a frequency of approximately 11 years, although this frequency is slightly different and they are offset in time. Combining both waves together and comparing to real data for the current solar cycle, we found that our predictions showed an accuracy of 97%. Sarkova says the next cycle is set to peak in 2022 and the cycle after, known as cycle 26, will lead to a new ice age. She continued, "In cycle 26, the two waves exactly mirror each other, peaking at the same time but in opposite hemispheres of the sun." And she said, "Their interactions will be disruptive or they will nearly cancel each other. We predict that this will lead to the properties of a Maunder Minimum. During the Maunder Minimum, temperatures dropped globally by 1.3 degrees Celsius, equals to 2.34 degrees Fahrenheit. Although it seems insignificant, it led to shorter seasons and ultimately the lack of food."
Most of our climate here on Earth has been friendly for the last few thousand years. But during most of the past 3 million years, the Earth has been much colder than it is now. And the regions where most of our food comes from were too cold to grow any food at all. Scientists have recently discovered that there has been a long series of recurring ice ages in the last few million years, with relatively brief periods of warmth in between. Each of these ice ages has lasted about 90,000 years on the average, while the warm interglacial periods between ice ages have averaged only about 10,000 years. This long cycle of major ice ages, approximately every 100,000 years, suggests that we can expect another one sometime soon. But what does soon mean in ice age time? And how much warning are we likely to have? And is there anything we could do about it even if we had some warning? Recent studies of ancient ice deposits and of underground layers of pollen from trees that lived 100,000 years ago suggest that last time, the final transition from a warm to an ice age climate happened incredibly fast. Not over thousands or even hundreds of years, but in less than 20 years. When the shift occurs, the climate in many regions of the Earth cools very quickly. Fruit and nut trees that need warm weather no longer grow in many temperate regions, and they are replaced by the kinds of trees now found only in areas like northern Sweden and Alaska. The glaciers will take many thousands of years to reach their maximum point, but the climate cools so suddenly that agriculture almost instantly becomes all but impossible in most regions of the Earth. Some recent evidence suggests that we may now be more than halfway through such a rapid, perhaps less than 20-year transition period, and that we may be less than 7 years away from the beginning of the next ice age.
In 1977, the worst winter in a century struck the United States. Arctic cold gripped the Midwest for weeks on end. Great blizzards paralyzed cities of the Northeast. One desperate night in Buffalo, eight people froze to death in marooned cars. Pat Bushnell was on the road that night.
Traffic just absolutely stopped. I was afraid of being stuck in the car all night long with the cold and the wind, running out of gas. And then what? I think that if we had to go through a real bad winter, just like we just went through, I think we'd have to think about moving someplace else.
Move where? The brutal Buffalo winter might become common all over the United States. Climate experts believe the next ice age is on its way. According to recent evidence, it could come sooner than anyone had expected. Of the nine planets in our solar system, only Earth has conditions favorable to human life. Our existence depends on a delicate balance of climate. Despite our modern technology, we are vulnerable to the whims of weather and environment. Blanketing large areas of the Earth's surface, great storms are among nature's most frightening events. Uncontrollable tempests make us aware how fragile life on our planet really is. The comfortable cycle of spring sowing, summer growth, and fall harvest is, in terms of long history, abnormal. Only in the last 10,000 years has Earth enjoyed continuing warmth. Because of this, our population has exploded to 5 billion people. For most of the last million years, however, whole continents were buried by ice. As recently as 18,000 years ago, a mile-thick sheet stretched down from the Arctic Circle and covered what is now Seattle, Chicago, and Boston. New York Harbor was choked with ice floes. Winters were cold and snowy down to the Gulf of Mexico. All that remains of the great glaciers that once covered North America are the ice caps of the Canadian Arctic. If the ice spreads over the continent again, it is here on Baffin Island in northern Canada that the mysterious process will begin. We look to this lonely outpost for warnings of a new ice age. Straddling the Arctic Circle, Baffin Island is a harshly beautiful wilderness. It is larger than California, but not one tree grows on the entire island. The only vegetation is the stunted plant life of the tundra. Most of the inhabitants are Inuit Eskimos, whose ancestors migrated west from Greenland 1,000 years ago. Today, the island is poised on the brink of ice age conditions, a critical signal post for changes in the Earth's climate. According to geologists, the last major ice age began on Baffin Island 115,000 years ago. Perpetual snow spread southward over the continents. The weight of many years of snow compressed into ice. The ice grew thicker until it covered Canada, the northern United States, and Europe to a depth of 2 miles. For 100,000 years, the ice remained over large areas of the continents. Then, it retreated to the Arctic. And for the last 10,000 years, we have flourished in a warm interglacial period. Our planet is crowded. What will we do when the fragile balance of climate shifts from today's abnormal warmth and the next ice age begins?
One of the questions that I'm frequently asked is, when will this present warm interval end? And the best answer to that probably is that it has in fact already ended, and it ended 3,000 years ago right here on Baffin Island.
Dr. Gifford Miller is a glaciologist from the University of Colorado. He's been studying the climate and glaciers of Baffin Island for the past 6 years.
For the last 3,000 years, the summer temperatures have been getting colder, and the amount of precipitation, rainfall and snowfall, has decreased so that the conditions have been drier and colder. And at the same time, the glaciers have expanded, and the most recent expansion, which occurred between 300 years ago and the turn of the present century, the glaciers attained their most extensive positions that they had during the last 8,000 years. The summer of 1972 was one of the most severe summers on record, and the ice never melted that summer. And when I returned to Broughton Island, one of the local settlements here, talking to the Inuit people, and they could only tell me that their fathers had told them of a time when the ice hadn't gone out.
This once-in-a-lifetime summer ice has surprised old-time Arctic residents. Ernie Sieber is superintendent of Baffin Island National Park and has lived in the Arctic for over 20 years.
We had, in 1973, we had ice all over at the East Coast. The fjords, some of the ice in the fjords didn't even leave. And almost every year since, we had ice moving in and out of the fjords. So it looks like the climate has changed. It looks like it turned colder.
Since concern for our weather has increased, the park wardens now take daily records of temperatures, wind, and solar radiation. Weather data from stations all over the Arctic is collected and fed into central computers. Balloons are launched every day to monitor the winds and temperatures at high altitudes. The data shows that average temperatures in the Arctic have fallen dramatically over the last 30 years. In most locations, the drop has been about 2 degrees centigrade. At that rate, the descent to ice age temperatures could take less than 200 years. It is not only the lonely Arctic that has cooled. The whole northern hemisphere is growing steadily colder.
There is little doubt that someday the ice will return. At least 8 times in the past million years, it has advanced and retreated with clockwork regularity. If we are unprepared for the next advance, the result could be hunger and death on a scale unprecedented in all of history. What scientists are telling us now is that the threat of an ice age is not as remote as they once thought. During the lifetime of our grandchildren, Arctic cold and perpetual snow could turn most of the inhabitable portions of our planet into a polar desert.
In Greenland, the snows of centuries have piled up on the largest ice cap in the northern hemisphere. Scientists have recently discovered evidence of a climatic catastrophe. Drilling down over 1,400 meters, geologists have collected precious samples of ancient ice. Some of it fell as snow over 100,000 years ago. The ice is shipped south, where it is kept frozen at minus 35 degrees and carefully divided up for study. By separating out the two forms of oxygen in the ice, scientists have been able to chart the temperatures when it fell as snow. Near the bottom of the ice cap, they found traces of widespread freezing occurring with dramatic suddenness. Dr. Chester Langway is chairman of the geology department at the State University of New York, Buffalo.
We have evidence from the ice core studies that approximately 89,000 years ago, the global climate changed from one of greater warmth than today into one of glacial severity. It is possible that a tremendous volcanic event occurred, shielding the sun, cooling the Earth's temperatures, and thereby providing the explanation of the advancing glaciers. The significance of this catastrophic event is that within a 100-year period of time, that the glaciers could have readvanced over the surface of the Earth. It is possible that we may enter into such a cold climate almost instantaneously in the very near future.
If the climate does suddenly cool, will we survive the change? Years ago, Manhattan Island was buried under a mile of ice. Where the Hudson River flows today, there was a huge glacier. Pack ice filled the ocean off Long Island. We're only beginning to understand the cyclic history of the ice, but evidence is mounting that another ice age is due. The most persuasive data comes from beneath the sea. The research ship Vima sails the world's oceans, taking samples of sediments deposited long ago. A crew of scientists rig a long cylinder and drop it vertically to the ocean floor. The cylinder dredges up mud from the seabed in the form of long cores. The types of tiny fossils found at different levels in the core shows the sea temperatures of the past. Geologists have collected enough sea cores to form a detailed history of climate during the last million years. The cores are analyzed at the Lamont Daugherty Geological Laboratory of Columbia University. Dr. James Hayes leads the research.
The climatic record in these deep sea cores tells us that there have been 8 ice ages in the last 700,000 years. It also tells us when they have occurred. This provides us with a test of various theories of the ice ages. We now have a theory that tells us that changes in the shape of the Earth's orbit act as a pacemaker for the ice age succession. Since this theory can precisely predict when ice ages occurred in the past, which can be tested against these deep sea cores, it also can predict when ice ages will occur in the future. From this theory, we can say with confidence that we are currently heading toward another ice age.
In the winter of 1976-77, one storm after another buried the Northeast under record amounts of snow. Months of brutal cold made much of the nation seem like the Arctic. In Chicago, temperatures hovered at 19 degrees below zero. Dayton, 21 degrees below zero. Cincinnati, 25 degrees below zero. Of all the hard-hit places, Buffalo, New York provides the best lesson. That unfortunate city had 44 consecutive days of snow. The first sudden blizzard paralyzed traffic. Thousands were forced to abandon their cars and seek refuge from the storm. Some who didn't were found frozen. As the storms continued, the resources of government were strained. Snow plows had to be flown in by the Air Force. Even the National Guard couldn't keep up with the unrelenting snow. Just how long can a modern city hold out when whole regions are cut off from food and fuel? When the weather turns on us again, how thin is the margin between life and death? When the snowfall finally stopped, downtown Buffalo lay quiet and deserted. Businesses remained closed for weeks. The airport was unusable. There was no way to reach or leave the city. The mail could not go through. Supplies of food and drugs ran perilously low. Ambulances could not reach the sick. For the old and infirm, it was a time of pain and misery. Suppliers of natural gas had to put emergency plans into effect, cutting off thousands of users. Electrical utilities ordered temporary blackouts. Fire engines froze in the sub-zero cold. In the suburbs, strong winds piled the snow in drifts as high as 30 feet. Many people had to enter their homes through second-story windows. No matter how much snow was cleared, fresh storms brought in more. Snowmobiles, the only viable form of transportation, were pressed into emergency service. Pat Bushnell remembers how the Buffalo storm began.
It was terrible. It was the worst winter that we have ever had around here. When I left work, knowing it was bad, but still thinking I could get home, gone maybe 3 miles from work and realized that the roads were closed at that point. You couldn't walk. The wind coming right off the lake at that point, it's right in downtown Buffalo, was so brutal that you just couldn't walk. So I sat for a while, just sat and waited in the car, and finally, you know, realized that it was hopeless. The thought of freezing to death, that's kind of frightening. My worst fear at that point was the children. I was worried sick about them. They were in the house alone. That was the biggest worry. To go through that every year just wouldn't be worth the fight. And it's a fight. It's a real fight.
500,000 workers in the United States were laid off because of fuel shortages. Hundreds died of illness made worse by the cold. Had the storms continued much longer, millions would have been in jeopardy for lack of food and fuel. The experience of 1977 leads us to imagine the disaster the future might bring. In the descent to an ice age, one severe winter would follow another. Eventually, the snows of Buffalo would never melt. Increased demand for heating fuel would trigger an energy crisis beyond anything we can imagine. Winters in Dallas and Atlanta would grow cold and icy. Snows would blanket Southern California and Northern Florida. The people of Mississippi and Alabama would have to contend with old-fashioned New England winters. Icy winds would sweep the Kansas wheat fields. Colorado's summer grazing lands would resemble the Arctic tundra. In California, glaciers would advance from the Sierra Nevada toward the fertile San Joaquin Valley. Food production would plummet. Prices would soar out of sight. Every winter, the line of year-round snow would move further and further south. If the catastrophic event of 89,000 years ago repeats itself, the ice could return within a single lifetime. If an ice age is coming, what can we do to stop it? Nuclear energy might be used to loosen polar ice caps. Sea ice could be melted by covering it with black soot to increase the absorption of sunlight. Dr. Steven Schneider is a climatologist from the National Center for Atmospheric Research.
Can we do these things? Yes. But will they make things better? I'm not sure. We can't predict with any certainty what's happening to our own climatic future. How can we come along and intervene then in that ignorance? You could melt the ice caps. What would that do to the coastal cities? The cure could be worse than disease. Would that be better or worse than the risk of an ice age?
If the polar ice melted completely, sea level would rise 180 feet. New Orleans, San Francisco, and New York would be submerged. Clearly, one of the future's great problems will be to survive the next ice age.
As governments and media continue their barrage of climate propaganda,
the National Climate Action Plan I unveiled will cut carbon pollution, protect our country from the impacts of climate change, and lead the world in a coordinated assault on a changing climate.
feeding Americans with failed predictions for man-made global warming.
And these changes are picking up speed.
Mother Nature has not heard their message as temperatures plummet across the planet.
The National Weather Service already calling this a crippling, potentially historic blizzard.
This Arctic blast is not just another winter storm.
A massive blizzard barreling down on the Northeast Corridor.
A growing number of climate scientists are challenging the establishment wisdom.
Not the weather extremes, it's important, it's the trend lines. And trend lines are clearly showing we're heading into a cold era.
John Casey's bestseller, Dark Winter, explains what's at stake with the coming Little Ice Age, as politicians bicker over carbon emissions.
It was never about the science to start with. It was always a political agenda.
What were you thinking? Why did you not act?
The world has never been spoken to quite this way. We've never been warned like this before, all of us, about climate change, nor have so many countries agreed quite this much on the clear and present danger it represents. Here is the takeaway. Unless the world changes course quickly and dramatically, the fundamental systems that support human civilization are at risk. This is all coming from the UN.
We've been told that Earth's climate has been changing. And for 30 years, scientists supporting the United Nations view have inserted the idea of man-made global warming into our consciousness, into our politics, schools, and even our churches.
There's one issue that will define the contours of this century more dramatically than any other, and that is the urgent and growing threat of a changing climate. We cannot condemn our children and their children to a future that is beyond their capacity to repair.
With current climate trends setting record cold temperatures, many are questioning global warming theories. And a growing number of climate scientists are seeing that global temperature data no longer shows a heating trend, and that most of the global warming predictions have failed to come true. And scientists who challenge the global warming consensus are now targeted for attack. John Casey is a highly credentialed scientist and engineer who has stood up to the establishment on global warming. He sees solar cycles as the primary driver of climate change, not carbon emissions. Casey's controversial new bestseller, Dark Winter, argues that global warming has ended and a new, more ominous threat faces humanity. A period of plummeting temperatures that's enveloping the planet that will radically change life on Earth, including political unrest, famines, mass migrations of people, and even a wave of unprecedented earthquakes and volcanic eruptions. Casey, a former White House Space Program Advisor and Space Shuttle Engineer, is the president of the Space and Science Research Corporation, a respected climate science organization. He has been a voice of reason challenging global warming propaganda, as he shows, along with a number of leading climate scientists, that the Earth has actually entered a period of rapid cooling as sunspot activity begins its downward trend. Not a member of the academic elite, Casey's scientific, real-world credentials set him apart.
According to NASA and NOAA's own science data and their satellite data that we monitor, the Arctic and the Antarctic are both getting colder. Sea ice is growing rapidly, and so the reality is quite different between what the warmest have predicted and what is really happening with our climate. This is even more graphic when you look at the relational cycle theory and what it predicted. For example, we predicted that the global warming would end between 2007 and 2010. We had a news conference in 2008 to announce that it had in fact already ended, that a new cold era had begun. All of the predictions then, and there are many, from the Space and Science Research Corporation and other global cooling researchers, have in general come to pass, whereas most of the major predictions from the UN and even our own U.S. science agencies in the last 6 years have failed utterly.
Al Gore, President Obama, the UN, and other global warming leaders, rather than admit their predictions have not come true, have chosen to attack the very scientists who have been proven right and have stood up to global warming narratives. Dr. Willie Soon of the Harvard Smithsonian Center for Astrophysics studies the impact of solar cycles on Earth's climate. Dr. Soon receives funding from the fossil fuel industry for his research because scientists backed by global warming funding have cut him off.
The sun, of course, in terms of its light energy output, is probably the only true external driver of the Earth climate system because there is no other forces on Earth that will supply that amount of energy for the air to move around, the ocean current to move around, or trees to grow. So there is no doubt that the sun is the main driver and supplier of energy to the Earth weather and climate system. They are clearly promoting the vision that if we do not cut our carbon dioxide emission, disaster, crisis, whichever bad connotation you can find, will come to Earth. So it is that kind of alarmism that appall me as a scientist. There is no one in the world who would insist that everything is having to do with the sun. All we are trying to do is that there's this plausible picture of how the sun could cause some of the changes in the climate system. Why not study it carefully? It's very, very difficult, in my opinion, to try to insist and suggest that carbon dioxide, even as of today, when we emit this carbon dioxide, it's going to drive the climate system. It's a complete false picture.
Climate change or climate variation occurs all the time, as it has for millions of years. These changes in climate are produced by, we believe, changes in solar or solar system gravitational field and energy output from the sun. As a result, we have studied, and I specifically have studied, a family of cycles that do cause this climate change. That includes a 206-year-long cycle, which is the one that is changing over now and ended the past global warming and has begun a new cycle of global cooling.
In January 2015, President Obama declared 2014 to be the hottest year on record, despite recent revelations that data he used is flawed or fabricated.
2014 was the planet's warmest year on record.
As the debate today rages over man-made CO2 and its link to global warming, and despite claims of 2014 being the hottest year ever, there has been a problem. Analysis reveals that for the past decade, global temperatures have, in fact, stabilized, and that some areas of the planet are actually cooling.
We've heard in the State of the Union address from President Obama that 2014 was the warmest year on record. Is that true? Is that accurate? Certainly the global warming camp will go along with that. I mean, this is the President of the United States making this statement. But on the scientific community side, those of us who follow temperature measurement and temperature trends know that the President wasn't accurate once more in his proclamations on climate change. 2014, according to five major global data sets that we follow on global temperature, both atmospheric and oceanic, says that it may have been the third or sixth warmest in the last 15, but was clearly not the warmest. What we've been told for quite some time now is that climate change of any kind is caused by mankind. That is a modification of what used to be called man-made global warming. When it became apparent that the Earth was cooling, that climate terminology shifted to just climate change, and in my opinion was simply a political co-op to include virtually any change of climate somehow being blamed on mankind. It is more a political definition than a realistic one.
A review of the five major global temperature data sets, records for the last 18 years, are far from conclusive that global warming has continued despite what we are being told.
The idea of science is you're really supposed to be skeptical, so there's always a quest to verify what we know, to understand that we haven't made a mistake, and that we continue on and develop science. If we've closed our mind, if we close the doors, we are now shutting ourselves out from the real truth, which is what science is all about after all.
How did global warming become a global obsession? A Hollywood storyline was not a bad way to start. In the next segment, John Casey confronts the conventional thinking on climate change.
It's pretty rare that you'll encounter somebody who says the problem you're trying to solve simply doesn't exist. Today's Congress is full of folks who stubbornly and automatically reject the scientific evidence about climate change. They will tell you it is a hoax.
Anyone who confronts the dogma of the day will find out that, like all other prior instances in history, you get ignored first, and then you get attacked.
It's pretty rare that you'll encounter somebody who says the problem you're trying to solve simply doesn't exist.
And it has always been a confrontation between establishment science and the mavericks that come along that say, hold it a minute, you need to consider something else.
In recent years, a handful of intrepid climate experts began seeing inconsistencies in the data supporting the global warming theory. Though all of these scientists agree that the planet had been warming for the past 200 years, the most recent climate data indicates the Earth's warming has stopped and temperatures are now either stable or cooling.
One member of Congress actually says the world is cooling.
Recently, Britain's Telegraph newspaper headlined the biggest science scandal ever. The paper reported that scientists had been caught tampering with recorded temperatures, from ones that showed a clear cooling trend to that of a warming one.
There's also a summary for policymakers. It's put together by policymakers, and in many cases, they go back to the scientists and say, can you change the science document to match our summary? We want to beef this up. We want to make it look worse. That's not the way science is done. What we have to remember is climate changes and climate fluctuates. And really, while we think humans have an impact on our environment, which we do, the global climate system is still far too complex to be simply affected by one change in one small component of it.
Climate experts like Dr. LaGates and John Casey think many experts are cooking the books. Climatologists challenging the global warming consensus believe the scientific data proves them right.
Today's Congress is full of folks who stubbornly and automatically reject the scientific evidence about climate change. They will tell you it is a hoax.
Anyone who confronts the dogma of the day will find out that, like all other prior instances in history, you get ignored first and then you get attacked.
It's pretty rare that you'll encounter somebody who says the problem you're trying to solve simply doesn't exist.
And it has always been a confrontation between establishment science and the mavericks that come along that say, hold it a minute, you need to consider something else.
In recent years, a handful of intrepid climate experts began seeing inconsistencies in the data supporting the global warming theory. Though all of these scientists agree that the planet had been warming for the past 200 years, the most recent climate data indicates the Earth's warming has stopped and temperatures are now either stable or cooling.
One member of Congress actually says the world is cooling.
Recently, Britain's Telegraph newspaper headlined the biggest science scandal ever. The paper reported that scientists had been caught tampering with recorded temperatures, from ones that showed a clear cooling trend to that of a warming one.
There's also a summary for policymakers. It's put together by policymakers, and in many cases, they go back to the scientists and say, can you change the science document to match our summary? We want to beef this up. We want to make it look worse. That's not the way science is done. What we have to remember is climate changes and climate fluctuates. And really, while we think humans have an impact on our environment, which we do, the global climate system is still far too complex to be simply affected by one change in one small component of it.
Climate experts like Dr. LaGates and John Casey think many experts are cooking the books. Climatologists challenging the global warming consensus believe the scientific data proves them right and shows that the sun's sunspot activity plays a much greater role in the Earth's climate than man-made carbon emissions. After years of research, Casey has published his book, Dark Winter, based on his relational cycle, or RC, theory. He says records of temperatures and atmospheric CO2 during the past 650,000 years indicate that Earth's temperature always rises first, followed by a rise in carbon dioxide by several hundred years.
A warmer Earth gives birth to more vegetation, which in turn has a more active carbon cycle. And so as a result, carbon dioxide may in fact follow atmosphere temperature change as opposed to being a leading indicator.
Published papers clearly shows that it is always the temperature rises first by at least several hundred years to a few thousand years. And then the carbon dioxide curve responds and it follows. So it is a very clear scientific consensus on this issue.
It's very important to understand that we were, in fact, in a state of global warming right up until the middle of the 2000s. But then it stopped. It stopped because the sun stopped it. It stopped on the sun because the sun's 206-year cycle reversed direction from warming to cooling. That's the big picture. It's nothing more complicated than that. And for those of us who follow the sun, that's why we're so encouraged with the reliability of these solar cycles. And I encourage everyone who used to believe the man-made global warming story, like I used to believe, to look into solar cycles, to look at solar activity, and for sure, for the next few years or few decades, please follow what's happening with the sun. And here we have the Northern Hemisphere, the tropics, and the Southern Hemisphere. Northern Hemisphere has been, as you can see, the 2003 to 2007 period where the peak occurred. It's been meandering, no change. Now see, this is what we were talking about. This is the secondary peak in the current 11-year solar cycle, which is more powerful than the first peak. Now, what that represented, unbeknownst to most people studying climate, is that the sun is sending us a signal that it's about to go into deep cold phase. This is a crucial signal from the sun that absolutely no one in the mainstream media is aware of. And in fact, most people in the scientific community are not aware of. But it's one that I found and wrote up the significance of this important event in the last Global Climate Status Report. But this is the crucial signal that we've been waiting for all along.
In the next segment, John Casey reveals how politicians have forced scientists to conform data to their global warming agenda. In 2007, with the help of Al Gore's Oscar-winning documentary, An Inconvenient Truth, global warming was catapulted onto the national and international stage. From the United Nations General Assembly in New York to the halls of Congress, global warming adherents have been sounding the alarm with scenarios of impending global chaos.
We've seen celebrities and prominent politicians like former Vice President Al Gore step up to the plate, issue a movie called Inconvenient Truth. He received an Oscar. He went on to receive the Nobel Peace Prize, along with Dr. Pachauri from the United Nations Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, for creating awareness of this threat of man-made climate change caused by CO2.
Faced with record cold winters now engulfing the planet, global warming theorists still won't change their conclusion that human-produced CO2 emissions are responsible for global warming, and that by the year 2100, a disastrous overheating of the planet will force wildlife species to the brink of extinction, melt ice caps and glaciers north to south, pushing sea levels upward, soon overwhelming us, flooding New York, Miami, San Francisco, and other major coastal cities around the world, as numerous and more destructive hurricanes were predicted to strike, and that the Arctic would be ice-free by 2013, and that global warming is not only real, but that it has been caused by human activity, and the United States economy is the leading villain. But none of their dire predictions have come true, yet they insist on massive government regulations and taxes on anyone using carbon-based fuels.
If we step back and we look at the big picture on this climate debate, we see that there are actually three groups involved. The first group is the best known. It's the one that's the man-made global warming theory caused by industrial greenhouse gases, primarily CO2, from our industry plants. This group is best known by the United Nations Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, the UNIPCC, and its periodic climate reports that espouse the greenhouse gas theory and say that the world is in danger and at great threat because of mankind's CO2. What we have found out since then is very different. And as a result, a second group has formed to oppose that first group. That first group also added President Obama in more recent years, a primary advocate for greenhouse gas and man-made global warming. We see that this second group opposes that first group. They have, in fact, done a great deal of research and come up with scientific rationale to show that the fundamental science of the greenhouse gas theory simply is not that important in climate change. But there is a third group. The third group is the one to which I belong and other scientists and climatologists around the world. We believe that the first two groups are really done a great job on the debate, but we need to stop the debate. And the reason we need to stop is because the sun is, in fact, the primary driver for climate change. And the new change, the new cold climate produced by the sun, demands that we all start getting prepared. We don't have much time left. I think it's important to understand that the vast majority of people are simply too busy with day-to-day life to really look into the question of what's causing climate change below the headlines of the news media, below the words from the news anchor on the evening news. What I have come to learn, the most important issue that we all face, is really how do you differentiate? What do you believe? Another example is the melting of the sea ice in the Arctic. We've heard many people predict when the Arctic would be absolutely ice-free. It never happened, of course. Other scientists from our own government agencies predicted it would be gone by 2013. That never happened. We were also told that ocean temperatures and atmospheric temperatures could only go up. Well, what's the reality? We now know after decades of global temperature tracking, especially during the satellite era, with very accurate data, that ocean temperatures actually stopped warming in 2003 and have been essentially cooling or stable since then. Who can the average person on the street trust when it comes to whether we're warming, whether we're cooling, and what data to use? If we look at the many predictions made by the UN Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, our own US scientific establishment, we see that they've made many predictions that have never come true. For example, the United Nations Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change has predicted that global warming over the last 15 years should have increased by 0.8 degrees Fahrenheit. It didn't even come close. The actual temperature measurement was 0.09 degrees Fahrenheit by one data set, and even colder than that by other data sets. The track record of the global warming community is a terrible track record, with error rates 90 to 300%, with major predictions like melting sea ice and glacial ice that simply haven't happened, with ocean temperatures and atmospheric temperatures that have stopped warming and now gone to cooling. So clearly, the solar physics community, the global cooling community, has gotten this one right for over a decade now.
In the next segment, John Casey reveals how a new solar cycle will radically impact life on Earth. In the aftermath of recent unprecedented cold winters, the UN and climate scientists are scrambling to explain their theories. When the scientific data and the experience of hundreds of millions living on the planet shows it is simply not true. Today, John Casey's book, Dark Winter, says the Earth is on the cusp of a significant drop in global temperatures as sunspot activity has already diminished and is expected to plummet to near zero over the next 5 to 10 years. Still, the UN and leading scientists and many politicians refuse to consider the impact of solar cycles on temperature. With their reputations on the line and untold billions of investment into the global warming theory at risk, questioning the near consensus thinking has not been allowed. In Dark Winter, author John Casey shows that the sun is clearly moving into a period known as a solar minimum, a period marked by greatly reduced sunspots and solar flares. As this solar activity declines, Earth temperatures will continue to fall, and these solar minimums have other consequences.
One of the other things we've learned about studying history and its relationship to climate variation has been a very startling component to this story. The fact that we have our very worst earthquakes and our very worst largest volcanic eruptions at the bottom of these cold solar hibernations.
Today's rate of volcanic eruptions is at the highest point in recorded history. Substantial volcanic activity is being recorded in Chile, Iceland, and the ongoing massive eruptions in Indonesia. The combination of increased volcanic activity and massive ash plumes distributed high in the atmosphere shield the planet from the sun and ensures the Earth will enter a period of intense cooling.
Research I've participated in with other eminent geologists around the planet is very clear on this. Our worst earthquakes and volcanoes, our worst geophysical events, happen at the same time the planet gets coldest. Let's look at the last time we had a solar hibernation in the 1793 to 1830 period, the Dalton minimum, if you will. The world's largest series of earthquakes occurred at that very time we were at the bottom of that solar hibernation. This was from 1811 to 1812. It didn't occur in Asia. It didn't occur in California or Mexico or Turkey or China. It occurred right here in the middle of the United States. Many people that live there know it well. It's called the New Madrid Fault. And the New Madrid Fault erupted with three catastrophic earthquakes, two 7.5s and an 8.0 approximately, within just a few months of each other during the winter of 1811-1812. If that same earthquake tragedy were to happen, the U.S. economy would be devastated. Hundreds of thousands would be dead. The infrastructure in the central U.S. would be totally destroyed. Also on the volcano side, 1815, at the bottom of the last solar hibernation, the last cold phase of the sun, the world's largest recorded volcanic eruption happened in Mount Tambora in Indonesia. Mount St. Helens, May 18th, 1980, that every American is aware of, was a catastrophic eruption as well, killed many people still living near the base of that volcano, caused dust to be scattered across much of the western, northwestern U.S. and the Rockies. However, Mount Tambora was 100 times the size of Mount St. Helens. The question of whether volcanoes have an impact on the climate is very real. It's another area that the UN Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change pretty much dismissed. It wasn't even in a major factor in these early reports.
On TV, in our workplaces and schools, Americans have been conditioned to believe that we are responsible for climate change. They have been exposed to a generation-long barrage of global warming propaganda, scare tactics, and manipulation of data to impose a socialist economic agenda on governments across the globe.
It's interesting when you look at the debate over the causes of climate change to see that the vast amount of data that's most accurate are being simply ignored. We still see those like Al Gore and those who oppose Al Gore go back and forth arguing over the role of CO2. But we see very little attention being paid to the most accurate theories, the most reliable science, and the best climate prediction records. They're totally ignored. Certainly one of the main contentions of the warming crowd has been the pointing to weather extremes as a sign of man-made global warming. Again, the reality is that that's not the case. Clearly, we should expect during a transition period from the past global warming to the new global cooling that we will see periodic interactions of deeper, more powerful cold fronts with the still existing warm fronts coming out from the tropics. That will produce extreme weather events, no question. But to say that man-made climate change as a result of CO2 from industrial plants is at the cause is simply not the case. There's been no real demonstration of the connections. So it's not the weather extremes that's important, it's the trend lines. And trend lines are clearly showing we're heading into a cold era. When people hear what I and others like me have to say, they're shocked. Their mouths drop open. They shake their heads. They can't believe what they're hearing because it's so compelling. And that's the power of the truth. But right now, we're still seeing the remnants of the 30 years of propaganda that says that mankind controls the climate, not the sun. These are ominous changes on the sun. Everyone needs to know about them and prepare for them. I am confident that we are growing. There are more people that are hearing this story, hearing the message, reading my book, Dark Winter, and books like it that tell the truth about the climate. So in time, I think we'll achieve the mission and that most of the people will have heard.
In the next segment, John Casey draws a picture of the looming disaster the new cold era will bring. As recent winters break record after record for snow and sub-zero temperatures, the global warming consensus is starting to melt away, making room for a new understanding of climate change. If predictions of a solar minimum causing intense cold prove true, how should people prepare for a cooling planet?
One of the other very important frequent questions I get during my presentations around the country is, okay, we accept what you're saying, but what do we do to prepare for this new cold era? The first thing we need to do is cross an intellectual bridge, a very difficult bridge, that transitions from the 30 years of global warming propaganda to a reality based on science and the most reliable science that tells us what's coming. Step number two entails studying history. Learn what happened in the last solar hibernations, the Dalton Minimum, the Maunder Minimum, the Little Ice Age. Study what people did, how they got through it, and how they reacted. And that will give you a good sense. The clear problem that begins, however, is one of food shortage. Unquestionably, that's the main ill effect of these cold eras, because the crops simply die. So what does that mean? It means that we've been able to grow crops at a much higher latitude than we've ever been able to. More crops at a higher latitude. Both of those components are going to disappear as the cold goes further south, as crops have to move further south to adapt. So what do? It means we better have our own food storage on hand. I recommend a one-year food supply. Be prepared to defend your home and your food supply. When we look back in history, when the food riots began, neighborhoods were destroyed. Farms were destroyed. Food granaries were destroyed. People would do anything back then to get food. That included killing their neighbors. We need to face the harsh reality of what people become when they start to starve. It's probably one of the worst lessons of history, but it's a lesson, unfortunately, our modern world will have to face in the coming times.
These solar changes will have a cataclysmic impact on Earth and lead to catastrophe for humans who do not prepare.
Still, there is optimism. Optimism comes from knowing what's coming, being prepared, being informed. It's far worse than being told that the Earth is going to warm, when in fact just the opposite is happening. Fortunately, people are now starting to listen to me since all of the predictions I made have come to pass. I want to expand on that. I want to get everyone aware that a new cold era will be coming. It's not the weather extremes that's important, it's the trend lines. And trend lines are clearly showing we're heading into a cold era.